Hi, I'm Don Famularo, and I have the wonderful opportunity to interview and speak to some of the greatest legends in the music industry. For thesessions.org, The Sessions is an organization that tries to bring to the global community the real passion that drives many different people who have literally dedicated their lives to become these great legends and artists of our time. I'm sitting right now with the great, legendary Alex Acuña. Alex, hi. I love every time I'm with you and we perform, we have fun and we laugh and we play great music. It's always the best with you for
it
sure.
It is.
But I gotta ask, where did it begin for you? When you first started in Peru, you were young. How young were you when you got involved with music, and where did that begin?
Yes, I was about 3 years old. What happened is that my father was a music teacher, a high school music teacher.
Wow.
He played every instrument, literally every. Yeah. And I had five older brothers, and my father taught him how to play music. You know, different instruments, piano, guitar, sax, trombone, trumpet, flute, you know, all that stuff, saxophone. But my mother told him, because I'm the youngest one, not to teach me, because she wanted me to be different, something different, not a musician.
Right, oh, interesting.
Yeah, so he never taught me, but when my father was teaching my brothers, I was there listening to all the lessons, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So I learned how to play a little piano, a little trumpet, just by listening, you know?
Yeah.
You know, I played trumpet for 6 years.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah, so.
So you understand all the other instruments.
Yes.
And did you ever perform together as a family?
Yes, we did. We had a band, the Necio Soup Acuña Orchestra. So yeah, we did a lot of gigs, and one day, my older brother that was the drummer, he took his girlfriend and they just left to get married, so they didn't have a drummer for that weekend. So my family said, who are we gonna hire now? So I said, I play drums. They said, but we never saw you play drums, what do you mean? So I said, well, try me. That was the first and the only audition I ever done in my life to my family. So we play one of the tunes, you know, Perez Prado tune. So, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And I play all the licks and everything. And they say, how do you know how to play? Well, I was listening. Every time when you rehearse, I was under the table listening to you guys play the music. I was around 10 years old, so that's when I started gigging professionally.
Right. And drum set was first for you, right?
Well, the Latin drum always been, for me, my drum was a set up of timbales, cowbell, one tom, a snare, hi-hat, and cymbal.
Right.
One cymbal, that was it. And it's been like that. But I, you know, percussion actually, I will say percussion called me to play them.
It's like
I didn't want it to be a pianist or a trumpet player or anything.
Yeah.
But every time I play the percussion, because of the touching the skin, getting the sticks and hearing the cymbals, was my love, and it still is. You know?
But you know, I've always seen you clearly as a drum set player and a percussionist.
Right.
I mean, you really do both of them very well.
Yes.
Many people are just percussionists, and they play a little drum set.
Right.
Or they play drum set and they play a little percussion.
Yeah.
You really have control over both areas.
Yes.
And that's very rare.
Very rare,
very, very rare to see that level.
Rare. Yeah, both two levels, yeah.
With your dad being a teacher, did you ever study lessons with other percussionists or drummers? Or?
Well, I learned to play, and then I became a professional studio recording session musician in Lima, Peru, when I was 16. My brothers were already established in Lima, and they said, come over, because you can read, you can play really good.
And how did you learn how to read?
Because I played trumpet.
So by playing trumpet?
And piano.
Oh, wow.
So those two things, I kind of figured it out. You know, I want to tell you, I didn't know rudiments.
Yeah.
I knew how to play by heart and reading,
right,
and music, playing only with the music, always music, you know, melodies and harmonies,
right,
following them. And then when I got to Lima, you know, they didn't want to give me lessons or anything like that, because the competition, they thought I was going to take their job, blah, blah, blah. So that's the other side of
it. Yeah.
But then when I came to the United States with Perez Prado, I was 18. He brought me from Peru to play here 9 months of tour. And after the tour, he left to Mexico and I went to Puerto Rico. When I went to Puerto Rico, I went to the conservatory and I studied mallets a little bit, and but mainly I wanted to know the drumming, you know, the reading, the rudiments, and that's how when I learned it. I was about 20, 21 years old.
So you began to formalize your learning?
Yeah, around 20
so
or 21.
Were you able to, in Peru, so you lived outside of Lima, were you able to listen to a lot of music? Was there a lot of live music there?
Yeah, no, actually, I'm still a listener to music. I listen to a lot of, you know, YouTube and
I saw you. Everything that, I saw you saying you watch myself.
Anyhow, I still listen to a lot of records and stuff like that.
Were there any musicians in, you know, any Peruvian musicians that you listened to that inspired you when you were younger?
Yes, my brothers.
Really?
Yeah, because they're excellent musicians. They play classical music, jazz, and everything. My father was an incredible teacher. So they very well prepared musicians, very great.
Wow, so you're, boy, this is amazing, because I know you do a lot of Hollywood film scores and movies. So,
yes.
And that, you know, from the classical end to the jazz end to the funk to the blues to the rock end, you really have an incredible diversity of ability of being able to play all kinds of music.
Yeah, actually, you need almost two lives to be able to play everything well.
Oh, I hear you.
But you know what I mean.
Yeah, I hear.
But what I'm trying to say, really, music for me, since I was a young musician, was one word, music.
Right.
So I never...
No labels. Right.
Ethnic, Latin, Brazilian, African, jazz, rock, classical. I listen to everything.
Wow.
No, I didn't prefer one than the other.
Right.
You know, I love music. That's why I can play djembe, I can play, you know, tablas a little bit. I can play drums, you know, all the percussion, Cuban and Brazilian and everything. It's an incredible plethora of genres.
So when did you leave South America and come to the U.S.?
1964. It's going to be 51 years in April.
So you were in your 20s, in your early 20s?
I was 18.
18, okay. Interesting.
Yeah, 18, that's amazing. Going to 19, yeah.
Yeah, so, and you came here, and you went directly to L.A.?
I came to New York for about a week, and then I saw Gene Krupa at the Metropole.
Oh.
On
he played there
Times
a lot.
Square.
Wow, that is really rare.
They didn't let me in because I was a minor. So I jumped on top of the car. And the next day, Woody Herman with this drummer, he died a few years ago.
Jay Khanna.
Jay Khanna.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Knocked me out. I said, whoa, those tempos in the back, big band.
Fast.
Clean. I said, oh, I couldn't sleep that week.
Oh, man.
And then I met a friend that they took me to see Miles Davis. Also, they didn't let me in.
Yeah.
So I had to just go to the alley and listen. You know,
the
like when I heard Tony Williams, I said, that's music from Mars.
Yeah,
I couldn't understand anything on those tempos, you know, like, beep, 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 beep. What is that?
Yeah, yeah. And Tony was young. Tony was only about 17 at the time.
We were born the same date,
really?
Not the same year. I'm a year older than December 12th.
Wow.
Tony and I.
It's amazing that you were exposed to that kind of music, from Gene Krupa to Miles. I mean, and in the New York area, they were all there.
Exactly.
There was a lot of energy at that time to hear. How long were you in New York for?
Just a week, 5 days of music.
Well, you got a lot in that week, man, I tell you.
A lot of, I went to see Tiro Puente also.
Oh, my gosh.
That's on the other side that I wanted to see. You
know?
So I was busy. No English. I think I'm still, you know, you can see how I speak English right now.
Your English
is
good. It's good.
But in those days, I only knew
zero.
How to say yes, no. That was all.
So you listened carefully. You heard the musicians.
Yes.
And from Gene Krupa in that big band era time. It's amazing, right, to hear that big band music, which a lot of young kids don't get to hear nowadays.
No.
But to hear 18 or 20 musicians playing together to create this excitement.
Yeah,
pretty powerful.
Those are the roots.
Those are the roots
of
for sure.
Our drumming, you know,
of modern drum set.
Modern
play.
Drum set now, those are the.
So then you make the move to California.
I came to California and met Perez Prado, you know, to fulfill the contract that I had with him, and we rehearsed here 3 days, and then we went to Las Vegas, at the Tropicana Hotel.
Right.
And we were opening for Count Basie.
Oh my.
At the Tropicana Hotel, we play in the bar.
Oh,
I don't know if you remember.
Absolutely. Who was on drums at that time?
Sonny Payne.
Sonny Payne. Oh, my God.
Sonny Payne. In a week, I saw all those
guys. Look what you saw. Boy, talk about a compressed education of magic in a short time. Wow.
In a short time.
Wow.
In less than 2 weeks.
Yeah. How different was being in America than what you had experienced in
It was like a dream. I had to...
In Peru.
You know, I had to...
Pinch yourself,
pinch
right?
Pinch myself to see, I'm alive? Yeah, I am alive.
New York, Vegas, you're in
Los Angeles.
LA, that's incredible.
I got to meet in those days so many drummers. Stan Levy.
Wow, Stan Levy was a great... He was a lefty.
Yeah.
He played lefty, yeah.
The faster...
Left hand, bing, ding, 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 ding. Yeah, he was a real,
you know,
real.
One of the guys that I said, wow, that's like a motorcycle, you know.
See, those are the names of the guys like Stan Levy and Sonny Payne that the young generation needs to hear about. And they got to research that and go to YouTube and Google that and really understand that these were players that inspired you. When someone wants to understand your playing, they got to go back and find out who inspired you.
Exactly. All those drummers, you know, it's a really a plethora of drummers and musicians.
Who would you say, if you had a name like a few drummers, three or four drummers, that really influenced you?
Elvin Jones.
Elvin, wow.
Yeah, Elvin, Buddy Rich.
Yeah, Buddy, wow.
And Roy Haynes.
Wow, Roy Haynes. Roy Haynes still going strong at 89.
Ooh.
In March, he'll be 90.
That's what I'm looking forward to.
That's a good example he set for.
And Tony Williams.
And Tony Williams,
yeah,
right?
Those days, yeah.
And did you have a chance to meet these guys?
I met Tony. Elvin, yes. I spent 1 week with Elvin in... Puerto Rico in San Juan.
Oh my God.
He went to see the classical performance of Don Pablo Casals, a cellist from Spain.
A cello player.
Yeah.
He was the best.
You know, Elvin was very knowledgeable about classical music.
Yes, I did know.
He knew all the composers. He knows everything about classical music.
He was very inspired by classical music.
Yeah, he knew the whole thing, yeah.
And Elvin played in such a unique way that he pulled from all of his experiences.
Well, I will say that he was, for me, the one that made me understood jazz. Because when he played jazz, I was able to dance.
Yeah.
I said, wow. Because the rhythm that he played is like the black rhythms that we play in Peru in the cajon.
Wow.
You know, I said, wow, it sounds like my Peruvian music.
The
black Afro-Peruvian music.
Interesting. Well, the jazz came from all that culture.
That's when I began to really grab jazz with John Coltrane.
And how important is dance? Like, did your family dance? When you were young, you danced?
Yes.
All the time, right?
I danced all the time. When I was about 4 or 5 years old, to get to see my favorite movies, I did a dance for the lady that was, you know, getting the tickets to let me in, because I had no money to buy the ticket. So I danced and sing and, you know, tap dance for her a little bit, and she let me in to see the movie. So I always dance.
Does that still work now?
Yeah, I
can still do it now.
That's a good one.
That's great. So
yes, I do that.
So the dance is important, the movement, the feel. Dance,
yes.
Because I find my sister's a dancer.
You see?
When I learned dance from her, I really believe that that's not only helped me with my drum set playing, but with my double pedal playing, my feet from tap dance. I think that gave the strength to the muscles to understand how to move my feet better, with more coordination. Yeah.
You know, it's a lot of things that I would like to explain or say or share. What happened is, I keep up with many things that I'm doing right now, martial arts.
Martial arts.
Two years now with Dan Inosanto, a guy that spent 9 years with Bruce Lee.
Wow.
Bruce Lee used to be a cha-cha-cha champion at 12 years old dancer in Hong Kong.
Is that amazing?
So this is just to put it together. Bruce Lee told him that dance, music, and martial arts is the same thing. Now you do understand.
Wow.
Because we do Cali, Filipino martial arts is Cali, and then we do the Silat, that is Malaysian martial arts.
Influence of martial arts.
Influence. But it's all like dance. It's like capoeira is a dance, you know, like that.
I've seen some of the Malaysian martial arts when I was in Malaysia.
Right.
It's almost like a ballet to a certain
extent. Right. Exactly. Yeah. So you can see, put it together, you know, music, dance, and martial arts is also, because it's coordination.
Yeah.
It's time, you know, it's movement, it's like dance. Yeah. So all that stuff.
And you stay totally current on everything. And now you're doing contemporary movies that are out.
Yes.
Recordings. I mean, you really have your pulse in all of exactly what's happening now. that it, age doesn't matter at all.
No,
it's
actually,
the spirit of what you're doing.
I think I'm playing better now than when I was younger, mainly because I have the time to practice. Before, I had to take every gig because to raise my five children.
Right.
You know, I needed money for milk, whatever.
Yeah.
But now I get up at 6 o'clock in the morning, get my coffee, and go to practice.
You practice.
And finally, I'm getting this technique. This, you know,
the traditional hand technique.
Because I play
you
like this
play
for many
years.
Yeah,
because
of the timbales. Now, you know, I'm learning the Freddie Gruber
and all the guys like all those guys that had played that way, Joe Morello and all those guys. I studied with some good guys that played that way, and it really was great to learn from those great masters. You, what's amazing is that you not only are you
just
involved,
continue, you know,
you're continuing in the process of learning. You love to learn, and I've always respected that about you.
Definitely.
What impresses me most is that aside from the list of great artists that you played with, Alex, you have played with some of the best.
Joni Mitchell,
everybody.
You too.
What's amazing is that you have different sides of you. You have your family.
Yes.
You have your missionary side of what you do.
Yes, that too.
The musical side. Tell me more about the missionary side of what you do.
Well, I'm working with four American missionaries that they, you see, music is the one that gives the platform for you to be with all these kind of people.
Right.
You know, music is responsible.
That opens the door.
Opens the door.
Wow.
When they find out that, you know, my country, especially in Peru, you know, maybe we can call Alex to do some concerts. We build this hospital or this school of this church.
Right.
So I take my family, you know, we are three generations, my sons and my daughters and my wife and my grandsons. We go with the three generations and we play music every time they inaugurate and open, you know, a situation like that. But yes, I've been doing mission since the 2000. So it's about 15 years now.
Boy, that's so exciting. My oldest son, Dominic, went to Lima, Peru to do a mission there, and he was there. And what
that's
he learned with the people and the great food and the love that they had for each other. And he worked and he helped. And it was so exciting, and he grew so much as a person because of it. But you're involved with things where they're actually getting wheelchairs.
That's right. These missionaries, they already gave 128,000 wheelchairs to the
128,000 wheelchairs.
Wheelchairs.
That's incredible.
And I was there. I took pictures, videos, and everything.
That's incredible.
And I saw that. And you know, they don't ask the government or they don't ask the churches.
Right.
They have some millionaire peoples in Texas that they put the money because when they see these people that they need that help, you know.
Wow.
So I'm glad to be in that team, you know, of missionaries. So I do that at least four times a year. You know?
And you explained that the wheelchairs were designed in a certain way.
That's right. They are like a bicycle tires.
Bicycle tires, yeah.
With a plastic,
like,
you know, lounge.
Plastic seating.
Lounge seating, yeah. And they cost about $80 from China to Peru. And so these people, they can maneuver themselves. They can move themselves.
Right.
And take their own showers and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, they also will free their family of taking care of them,
so they can
work.
They become more independent.
Independent.
And that gives them more self-esteem.
Amazing.
And that raises the level of the spirit in these people. That is powerful.
That's what it
that
is.
That really is powerful.
That's besides the music and the profession and the family and all that. But I have time to do all of that.
Yeah, well I think that what's I've always been amazed about you is you make the time.
Yes.
You make it happen.
You have to make
I think that's an important lesson to understand about you. It's not just you're on stage and you play drums and percussion great and you're a great musician.
Yeah.
There's many sides of you to raise a beautiful family that you have, to have this incredible musical career that you have, to influence all the different people that you influence, to put this missionary statement on, and then to have this incredible, you know, opportunity of playing many of these movies.
Yes.
This is incredible.
That profession, because it's a love that I don't think it fades. You know, sometimes other things fade, but not love. The love that we have, you know, it's not just an emotional situation, you know, it's not just a passion.
Wow.
A passion can go up and down.
Yeah.
But the love is steady, you know what I mean?
Is there any one memory is there any one thing that stands out to you that you remember so well with all the stuff that you've done?
Yes, definitely. When I start playing with Weather Report,
wow. The beginning stage.
For me it was like I went to Juilliard for 5 years.
Wow. Good
because composition,
right,
interpretation, you know, a lot of improvisation.
Yeah.
Well done.
Yeah.
You know, I admire how the three of them, like Sawinul, Wayne, Jaco, were able to choose the notes for the soloing.
Right.
Every day was different.
Yeah.
Wow, what a big, amazing.
Yeah, what a world of knowledge.
You know, wow. Yeah, yeah. And then how they, every day they play so different, because Weather Report wasn't, we play very open. We knew the chart, the music, the melody, the chords, and the style, the genre of that tune and everything. But when we perform every night, was a totally different than the night
absolutely,
before.
Absolutely, yeah.
You know, so fresh all the time. Yeah. It's like bubbles.
But
know?
It almost seemed like with Joe Zawinul, it had to be different every night.
Yeah.
If it was the same, he didn't like that. He wanted it different.
And the other thing, Zawinul was able to really pull out of you the best that you have that night.
Yeah.
That's the best you're gonna give me tonight. I'm gonna take it out tonight.
Yeah.
And he will do that by playing, you know, by playing music in many different ways, you know. For example, when they play together, Wayne and Joe, a solo, soprano, and acoustic piano. You know, he's one of the best acoustic piano players in history. I had to be there. I said, every night was different.
Yeah.
And they knew each other because it was improvised. How someone who really follow him harmonically. Oh my gosh. It's indescribable. You have to really listen to it.
And you have to listen to it. That's why I say, I think the great thing about what the Sessions organizes with these interviews is that this will last forever for people to go there and research and listen and understand the music and the artists. Joe Zawinul, Wayne Shorter, Jaco Pastorius. Oof. What great, great legends. I get the chance soon to interview Peter Erskine.
Which
is a whole nother level of drumming of what's happening.
Definitely.
If you had to share a closing statement with the people that are listening, who listen to it now, people will listen to it in 5 years, in 10 years, in 30 years, in 50 years, they'll be researching Alex Acuna.
Probably.
If you had to share something with them, what would you share in a closing, you know, understanding of what you feel for the future of drumming and the future of music and the future of all these students?
Yeah, you know, it has to be something personal that I also, you know, we all of us went through that. You know, how are we going to get there? What is the motivations and all that stuff to be able to be established later on time?
You know? Yeah.
For me, it was the love, the gift, and most of all, the vision. The vision that I had inside, it's a deep, it's like a dream, a desire, like I wish, I want, I have to, but I back it up with discipline, with perseverance, you know, but never lost the vision, still not losing the vision, to continue to play until the day I won't be able to hold the sticks.
Right.
So I get up every morning to play. I play in the mornings, you know, 2-3 hours, practicing my hands, my feet, so I can be lifting up the beautiful art that was given to us.
Right.
So it will continue to grow and to grow, or whatever, keeping to give the best that has been given to us.
How powerful is that? To give the best that has been given to us. You are the best, Alex. I love you so
much.
Thank you
so much, man.
It's so great to have the opportunity with the Sessions, thesessions.org, to review this, understand this, do the research. I thank you so much, Alex. You are absolutely the best in the world.
Thank you.
We thank you so much. Listen, learn, and go out there and play music. Thanks so much. Bye-bye.